एक विषय जो सुष्मिता जी ने सबसे पहले उठाया, मुझे लगता है कि हमारे पार्लियामेंट के इतिहास में भी ये एक पहला उदाहरण है कि ये बिल मई के महीने में इंट्रोड्यूस हुआ, जॉइंट कमेटी को गया और जुलाई के महीने में जॉइंट कमेटी ने अपनी यूनानिमस रिपोर्ट एक के बाद एक सिटिंग करने के बाद दे दी और सरकार ने सारी रिकमेंडेशन मान लिया। जब 1 अगस्त है जिसमें हम ये कानून पास कर रहे हैं, शायद संसद में कमेटी सिस्टम्स की इफेक्टिव फंक्शनिंग का ये अपने आप में एक उदाहरण है। एक विषय मैडम, बेसिक क्वेश्चन विच अ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ मेंबर्स हैव रेज्ड विद रिगार्ड टू एनपीएस एंड विलफुल डिफॉल्टर्स। मिस्टर प्रेमचंद्रन सेड दैट विलफुल डिफॉल्टर्स शुड बी प्रोसिक्यूटेड। इफ केसेस फॉर prosecution under the penal code are made out, that is to say there is any kind of siphoning or diversion of money and a person is declared as a willful defaulter, then certainly there are prosecutions in those cases. It is not that you can be a willful defaulter and get away with it. NPA is slightly different. NPA is a case where people have taken loans for the purposes of some activity, commercial or otherwise. There is nothing per se against taking loans from banks. So we must always distinguish between loans which are pending, because banks giving loans is a good thing. Banks support growth by giving loans. And therefore, if loans stop coming, growth itself will stop. So per se, there is nothing wrong with loans pending, but loans will have to be serviced. That is to say, you have to pay back the interest, you have to slowly pay back the principal amount. And when a person is not able to pay back the interest after a certain period of time, say 90 days, the account becomes an NPA. An asset is performing as long as it is servicing the bank. The moment it stops servicing the bank, it becomes non-performing. Now here we are faced with the banks are also faced with the Hobson choice. There could be several reasons. One reason could be what Premchandran mentioned, that somebody has siphoned out money, diverted money, which is a criminal offense. There may be other cases where loans have been wrongly given. Now there are ethical questions in that. But then there can be a third category also, where loans were rightly given, they were given to good units, and for some reason the business cycle has taken an adverse turn and that particular industry gets adversely affected. At that stage we are faced with a question: do we paralyze the entire sector itself and result in losing thousands and lakhs of jobs as far as that sector is concerned? Obviously, the state can't do it, the banks don't want to do it, that's not in larger public interest. So all efforts are then made in order to ensure that these units continue to function, because these units, if they continue to function, workmen will get jobs, taxes will be paid, there will be economic activity in the interest of the country. So the Reserve Bank keeps coming out with the various circulars which empower the banks. You can have a corporate debt restructuring. You can have an SDR where some part of the debt can be converted into equity. You can bring in a strategic partner from outside and hand over the management to somebody else. Then there is the JLF mechanism by which the lenders itself acquire a larger role. And therefore, in each of these instruments is applied to make sure that the unit keeps functioning, jobs are not lost. At the same time, the asset can also be preserved. For instance, the largest loans today really are 4 or 5 sectors. I have said this in this house earlier also. The steel sector over the last few years has been facing a stress. And it's been facing a stress in a large number of countries. And the reason was low global demand because of the global slowdown. And as a part of the low global demand, it is believed that Chinese steel was flooding these markets, including the Indian market, at less than cost. And when cheaper Chinese steel was coming into India, our steel mills were not being able to work to the best of their capacity. Their demand became less, accompanied by the global factors. And therefore, our steel companies went into the red. So a large number of steel accounts, some of the largest blue chip companies like Tisco, SAIL, etc., also face challenges. Now, these are core sector industries. We can't afford to let any one of them close down. And therefore, the best possible option has to be made in order to keep these sectors going. So one of the larger solutions is that the government of the day has a responsibility with regard to policy, how to revive that sector. So we increased some customs duty. We then tried some duties on the subsidies that the Chinese were giving. Finally, what seems to have worked in the last few days was that for a temporary period, we have put a minimum import price, that no steel below a certain price can get into India. United States took a more aggressive action. They imposed various forms of anti-dumping duties. In some case, the duties went up to 280% on the Chinese steel. UK could not do it because the European Union didn't do it, and that is why you had the problem with the Tata Steel plant in the United Kingdom. And therefore, these are issues which won't be settled by securitization action or by DRT. They would have to be settled by policy itself. Now, after steel, infrastructure projects was another sector which was where large debts were pending. Even still, they are pending. The third important sector was power. And in power, the cancellation of the coal blocks, coupled with low demand for power because of the global and the domestic demand being low. And then a third factor came in, which I have mentioned in this house earlier, that several state governments, through their electricity boards, decided to subsidize farmers power to certain segments of the society, some in case of farms, some in case of domestic, some in case of industrial sector. Now, under the 2003 Electricity Act, subsidy has to be paid by the state government from its own budget to the electricity company, if you want it. They didn't do that. Instead, they just allowed the electricity companies, the distribution companies, the DISCOMs, to take loans from banks. So literally lakhs of crores, when this figure of 8 lakhs and 6 lakhs is being mentioned, a very large part of it is the monies owed by DISCOMs to the banks. And the DISCOMs are neither paying back the principal amount nor the interest. So again, the government has stepped in. The Ministry of Power came out with the Uday scheme, by which the state governments must take over the debt, issue bonds, and so that the debt of the power companies is reduced. And then slowly the power companies over a period of time increase their tariffs so that they charge for the power that they supply. So the power sector could be revised. National highways, sugar, these were other sectors which were sick. Some of them have shown recently signs of revival. So the real answer is that as far as the big loans are concerned, the economic cycle itself will have to take care of a large number of them. At the same time, people who are not able to service it, the banks are today putting a lot of pressure on them. We must be reading about a group with 5 units or 6 units having been compelled to sell 2 of them so as to repay back the banks. So they are coming out with the solutions under the RBI circulars of this kind. The third methodology is that banks must also be empowered to take effective legal action against the defaulters. Now, one of them was the insolvency law, the bankruptcy law, where a company is turning bankrupt and is unable to discharge its debts. Rather than the debts being squandered away and getting rusted, somebody has to step in and take over the assets so that people, if a revival is possible, a revival takes place. If it's not possible, then the assets could be adequately distributed from workmen downwards. Everybody gets his own share as far as those debts are concerned. These two principle laws, securitization and DRT, are also steps in that direction. As far as the DRT law is concerned, we have said not more than two adjournments. The whole system is now intended to become electronic. You file your cases electronically, the replies are electronic, and you try and dispose of matters as quickly as possible. Judgments can't be reserved for more than 30 days. Recovery certificates must be expeditiously issued. One of the difficulties we were also having in finding good presiding officers and of both the DRTs and the appeal tribunals. So the age also has been relaxed a little in the present amendments. The second part of the amendment is with regard to the Sarfazi law, wherein the bank is empowered to take over the asset, which is the security. And once you take over the security, then the debtor will start chasing the bank and coming out with some kind of a settlement. So the security at least can be protected. The security can be given to the asset reconstruction company, and that asset reconstruction company will then transiently hold it till a new person can step in and then revive that same asset. So the idea being, the unit must go on, it must become economically more liquid, and the jobs are not lost in the whole process. Several honorable members have raised various questions. One of the questions that Premchandran again mentioned was with regard to agricultural land. No, the answer is farmers' agricultural land is exempted from securitization under Section 31I of the Act itself. So that is not a question which is, and it remains outside the Securitization Act. With regard to settling these small loans, a question Mr. Chandu Majra raised and other members raised, bar bar wahan banks jo 20 lakh se kam udhar hote hain, unki bahut bade paimane mein lok adalate karte hain. Aur lok adalat mein ready compromise ki bhai kitna de payega, kitni kishton mein de payega, inki settlement ho jati hai taki usme unko phir mukadma dair na karna pade. One of the question Mr. Chautala raised was ki central registry kab establish hogi. Central registry 31 March 2011 se establish ho chuki hai, it's now functional. Mr. Venugopal raised several issues. One was with regard to the notification to extend Sarfazi to systematically important NBFCs. The draft notification has already been placed, objections are awaited, and as soon as it's possible under law, the final notification will also be issued with regard to that. Unlisted debentures cannot come within the purview of Sarfazi because they are not regulated by SEBI. It's only those which are regulated by SEBI, which are the listed debentures, which can come within the purview of Sarfazi. Now, Section 32 says that you can file it where the account is operated. So when you said any other office of the bank where a petition can be filed, where the account is maintained. If the account is maintained in Chennai, the bank can't file it in Srinagar merely because it has an office in Srinagar. It will file it in any place where the account is, itself is operated. ARCs pay 15% down payment, and for 85% they have to give their own security, so that they are a transient body, so that the asset is preserved and then it can go to the person who will eventually run it. That's the system on which the ARCs themselves function. ARCs are regulated. If the performance of an ARC is not satisfactory, it is regulated by the RBI itself. So we can trust the RBI that they will take whatever actions that the RBI in this regard is taking. Similarly, Mr. Satpathy's point with regard to RBI having the power to remove the chairman, etc., that's a part of the regulatory power which any regulator itself will have. A question which Mr. Satpathy raised was that land is a state subject, so it's a leasehold land of the state, will it revert back to the state? The leasehold rights will remain with the person who takes it over. So there will be a transfer of the leasehold rights itself, because a leasehold right is also a valuable commercial right. So the, just because it's on lease with the state, the land cannot revert back to the state. There was a suggestion by Mr. Gala on the expansion of the definition of the word borrower. It has already been extended to the NBFCs. He wanted strict action. If people don't file documents in time, etc., the DRT should be able to pass a decree straight away. Well, that's a power which a DRT has. That's a judicial power, and we must trust their judicial judgment, because it's after all headed by a district judge. Mr. Khan wanted to know whether we could club the bankruptcy code and surfazi together. Well, they are a part of the same umbrella, but they have different defined jurisdictions, and therefore both of them itself will remain. With regard to Mr. Atsul's point, with regard to the extension to cooperative banks, the issue is Supreme Court has taken an alternate view, and therefore unless the law is amended at a suitable time, that itself under the present law would not be possible. There are some litigations which are still pending in the Supreme Court in this regard itself. We can consider, I have noted your suggestion, I will adequately take control note of this. The qualification somebody wanted to know for presiding officer of DRT is a district person qualified to be a district judge. For the appeal tribunal, it's a high court judge. Madam, these are the various questions which have been raised.
I was listening to you, take care of yourself. You are driving cars. We
are not driving cars, you will not keep your gulf. You will not keep your gulf.
मैं कह रहा हूँ अब बोलिए मैं कह रहा हूँ अन्नेसरी।